Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Church of the Wild, How Nature Invites Us into the Sacred, by Victoria Loorz. Narrated by Natasha Soudek. Prologue. This is a story about a land where the trees talk and the waters croon, and the people fall in love with birds who love them back. This is a story about an enchanted forest hiding in plain sight, invisible until, somehow, the veil drops, and what was unseen can suddenly be seen. You may catch a glimpse when you cross the threshold on the far edge of the abandoned field, or when, just for a blinking instant, you notice how the brambles of the blackberry bush connect you to everything. The ancestors knew this and reminded one another around their fires that they belonged to a great web of life. They were called into wilderness by a voice that spoke in words planted silently in their hearts, by the voices of the cedar trees, the lilies, the desert sands, sacred voices tucked into pockets of the wind. Some of these ancestors were called out of Egypt, out of oppressive systems that didn't acknowledge their lives as valuable, called into the wilderness to listen, to prepare, to be tested and encouraged and strengthened. There, the wild creatures of the night, the fiery bushes and cool streams, and the manna that fell from the sky reminded the people of their true identity. Once upon a time, all humans knew their lives, their food, their survival, their sense of meaning and kinship with God or the gods was connected with all their relations, the hawks and soil and ferns and mosquitoes. Like all the other wild creatures, they belonged to the land. And they knew it. They were untamed and self-willed and listened to their own intrinsic authority. They were part of a grand conversation, a relationship of reciprocity and respect, connecting them with all the other beings and elements of life. But there came a time when some of the people could no longer hear the conversation. An elixir fell over the poppy fields, like Dorothy entering Oz, causing them to fall asleep. The wax in their ears became hardened, and their hearts pretended that they were happier controlling the world than loving it. They rushed right past the burning bushes on the way to importance, missing the message of the doe hiding in plain sight with her newborn fawn. They packed the bodies of sacred forest cathedrals onto trucks and shipped them to mills. They forgot that the thrush songs spelled out warnings and wisdom in octaves. Disconnected little by little, their voices went missing in the symphony of aliveness. The songs of the wild god cascading through the trees no longer guided their lives. And a deep loneliness sunk down upon the people, like a heavy fog nobody could see. The time has come to lift that veil of fog and return to intimate relationship with the living world. More and more of us are taking our place, once again, as full participants in the web of life, which we remember is held together by love. There are no magic words to incant, no spiritual laws to memorize, no ruby-slippered heels to click three times. You don't need to read 100 new eco-theology books or leave the church or become an animist or a pantheist, but you can if you want to. You simply need to learn how to listen and allow your heart to be broken, just like you do every time you fall in love. Because the holy is in your place, too. You open the gates into this enchanted land, your home, with hands muddied from the soil outside your house and a raw, scabby, and unprotected heart. You enter naked and brave. 1. A communion of subjects. The divine communicates to us primarily through the language of the natural world. Not to hear the natural world is not to hear the divine. Thomas Berry, The Sacred Universe, 20th century CE. On the edge of the Barranca, behind the 1970s Southern California suburb where I was a teenager, among the sagebrush and valley oaks, I had a place. Before it was completely developed into million-dollar homes, this canyon's edge of the Barranca was my place. I never brought anyone else there. I never talked about it to anyone. It was a secret. I liked the getting there nearly as much as the being there. The path wandered through tall-as-me wheat-looking weeds that squeaked when you pulled the heads out, boulders and even taller brushes of scrubby sage and laurel sumac to find a particular path, a deer trail that looped around the edges of the Barranca wall. The entrance was appropriately hidden. To recognize it, you needed to train your eyes and leave markers like stones atop one another or a small ribbon tied to a broken branch. It took me several visits before the homing beacon of the place would draw me there without annoying backtracking. But once I knew precisely where to put aside the scratchy pointed leaves of the sprawling oak brush, my place would be revealed. It was a small clearing on a scrubby cliff that looked out over a mysterious campground that I couldn't quite see. The acoustics of the canyon allowed me to listen in on entire conversations of strangers at the campground who didn't realize the walls amplified their voices. I felt deliciously invisible, imagining whole lives of the unseen, but clearly heard people beneath the rocks 60 feet below me. But the humans were not my primary interest. The hawks were, the lizards and spiders were, the cloud structures, the warm Santa Ana winds. A particular scrub jay stopped being a bird in the background and became a sacred other, one whom I encountered in second person. She became familiar to me, and I would look for her every time I visited. I made a circle with rocks, and around that, a square with sticks. And inside the circle, a triangle with three branches. I was adapting a symbol I knew from YMCA camp. A cross in the middle of a triangle, in the middle of a square, in the middle of a circle. It just didn't look right to me, so I rearranged it. In the middle of the triangle, where the cross is supposed to go, was the space for me. From this vantage point, at the crest of the Barranca cliff, protected by amulets of ritual I didn't fully understand, I would sit and listen and watch. Twice a year, sheep grazed in the fields on the other side of the canyon. Sheep. In fields. Buying. Seriously. In my suburban California town. That doesn't happen anymore, but even then it felt surreal. They even had little cowbell collars. It was so enchanting that those sheep still show up in my dreams. In my world of swim meets, algebra exams, and long notes to my best friend left in her locker, those sheep were threshold totems, inviting me into another world. Once, near dawn, a single curious doe came to see what I was doing. She didn't notice me at first, but when our eyes locked, she didn't run. As we stared at each other, I saw her alarm melt into curiosity, and some kind of deep knowing passed between us. I didn't even try to understand it. I felt honored and grateful. It was a sacred moment, though I didn't use those words then. I longed for her return every time I went to my place. In fact, the hope of seeing her again was half the impetus to head out there at least once a week. She only returned once, which was a little disappointing and confusing, until I read about a similar encounter Mary Oliver captured in her poem, The Place I Want to Get Back to. The poem, which is about a numinous visit by two does, explains that such gifts bestowed can't be repeated. They can, however, become beacons to show you the way. Numinous presence through deer became an important beckoning toward the divine for me, a gentle nudge to pay attention. I didn't know it then, but I was learning ceremony. I was learning to meditate. I was learning prayer. I was learning that God is found in the bushes, hidden from the trail, in communication with the birds and the wind, and in the trusting visit of the deer. My place was slowly turning into our place as I recognized that I belonged to a much larger story. It took many years before I had a clue that this private ritual I had as a teenager was calling me into relationship with the land, the world, the sacred, and my own soul. I was unaware that the relationship I built with this particular place held the DNA for a calling and expression of vocation that would develop in my life. I didn't realize that this little sanctuary was an initiation into my own direct experience of God, my first church of the wild. Nearly 40 years later, a small group of brave souls launched Ojai Church of the Wild with me. I'd been imagining it for a few years, a way to redefine church and reconnect with nature by meeting outside, without walls that block out the rest of the world. Under a cathedral of live oak branches, the altar would be a mandala created with acorns and dried leaves and rusted bits of barbed wire. I longed for church to be a place where mystery is experienced, not explained. The core of the service would be an invitation to wander on our own, to connect with the natural world at our own contemplative pace. We would find or create spiritual practices that re-remember ourselves back into our home terrain as full participants, reading from the first book of God, which is what the ancients called nature. The liturgies would include the whole world, not just humans. And instead of sermons from one preacher, we would learn how to enter into conversation with the living world. Sitting in a circle, not in rows, we would share our wanderings with one another and listen for the voice of the sacred in the sermons of the trees and the gnats and the crows. And that's what we did. After 20 years as a pastor of traditional indoor churches, I walked out the chapel doors and into the sanctuary of the oak trees. A small group of us put ancient yet new spiritual practices into place that reconnect us with the living world as sacred, and called it church. When I first founded Church of the Wild in Ojai, California, I felt a little insecure, like I was just making things up. But I wasn't. The idea of wild church was in the zeitgeist, a mysterious work of spirit that had landed in the hearts of many across North America. And of course, this was nothing new to people whose spirituality had never been severed from the soil where they live. Church of the Wild is not a new, trendy form of church for people who shop at REI and backpack the Pacific Crest Trail. Gathering in this way is more than connecting with the natural world in order to reduce your blood pressure or obtain any of the other proven benefits of time spent in nature. It's not even a sneaky way to get religious people to care about climate change. It is a movement of people who are taking seriously the call from spirit and from earth to restore a dangerous fissure, spirituality and nature are not separate. This book is not about starting a wild church community, although you can if you want to, and there are resources at the end of the book if you are interested. Rather, I hope this book encourages in you a wild spirituality. I use the phrase Church of the Wild in a broader sense throughout these chapters. The word wild is not meant in the colloquial sense of out of control. Rather, I use it to refer to the natural, innate way the world was created, not controlled or tamed or domesticated. Reclaiming wild is reclaiming who you were meant to be, who the world is meant to be, which isn't static. Wild means swirling in dynamic and even loving relationship because all wild things are naturally interconnected. I use the word church as a place of intentional connection with the sacred. For some, church is a trigger word, recalling bad experiences. I understand that, but I think some words are worth recontextualizing. Placing church into a new context of wild instantly reframes it as a sacred space outside of human-made buildings and dogmas and control. I use the preposition of intentionally too. I mean that church is not just in the wild, but of the wild. The sacred connection is fully in relationship with, and even initiated by, nature. We are in trouble because we do not have a good story, Catholic priest and evolutionary theologian Thomas Berry often said. We are between stories. The old story is no longer effective. Yet we have not learned the new story. We are talking only to ourselves. We are not talking to the rivers. We are not listening to the wind and stars. We have broken the great conversation. By breaking that conversation, we have shattered the universe. Over the last 30 years, I've wrestled with this broken conversation as a pastor of indoor churches, a climate activist, a mother, and now as a guide who leads people in spiritual practices that reconnect them with the natural world. I've discovered something I've known deep down all along, but never had the cultural, religious, or even internal permission to embrace. Spirituality and nature are not separate. Attempts to keep them apart break the world. This book is a prayer to help us restore that conversation. In doing so, we participate in the emergence of the new story. It will emerge through us. The old story continues to be exposed as a story constructed in service to white supremacy and patriarchy. I'm writing this in the days of the COVID-19 pandemic, watching helplessly as forests on the West Coast burn and the ice in the Arctic melts. Ongoing police violence against Black people has triggered protests that are finally starting to wake up white people. At least some. There's not a single institution unaffected. We are staring at the slow-motion collapse of an empire, standing at the threshold of profound change. We as a society are being asked to reckon with the reality that a selected few have benefited from a patriarchal society that has taken the gift of life on Earth and treated it as a right. Those in the dominant Western culture have demanded not just the fruit of the tree, but the whole tree, and the water and sun and birds and beetles too, and consumed it all, as if they were the only ones who mattered, as if the rest of the earth were here for their taking, for a person, group, or species to act as if they are the only ones who matter. They need to strip the inherent worth of those they wish to dominate and objectify them. Otherwise, domination is impossible. Professor, philosopher, author, and visionary Carol Wayne White observed the same root of objectification underlying racial oppression, citing a lethal combination of intimately conjoined white supremacy and species supremacy. Both of these impulses, white supremacy and species supremacy, evoke a hierarchical model of nature built on the great chain of being concept, and they have produced violent and harmful consequences. The hierarchy that Dr. White names is deeply embedded in every aspect of our society and worldview. The needs and desires of those on the top of the pyramid are prioritized. Everyone and everything else is objectified and valued according to their usefulness by those on top. Forests become lumber, cows become beef, deer become game, land becomes private property, people of color become cheap labor or a threat. A false belief system of separation and dominance is opposed to every system of life, with disastrous consequences ecologically, spiritually, culturally, socially, economically, and every other lee you can think of. These worldviews are so deeply embedded that it takes a lot of effort to even see them, much less change them. The layers of crises and cruelty we face will not be solved with technological, political, or economic strategies alone. A deeper transformation of heart is necessary to welcome in a new story. Moving away from a worldview and a way of life that treats others as a collection of objects toward a new way of being human that participates honorably in a vast communion of subjects is what Thomas Berry calls the great work. The great work is spiritual at the core. Gus Speth, an environmental attorney, ecologist, and climate advocate, has summarized the problem brilliantly. I used to think that top global environmental problems were biodiversity loss, ecosystem collapse, and climate change. But I was wrong. The top environmental problems are selfishness, greed, and apathy. And to deal with these, we need a spiritual and cultural transformation. And we scientists don't know how to do that. Do we spiritual people know how to do that? I spent 20-plus years in church leadership, and spiritual transformation was rarely, if ever, connected with actual cultural change that addresses these problems. I also spent a dozen years as a nonprofit leader in the climate movement, where spiritual transformation meant something more like engaging faith communities in the campaign of the moment. But it rarely meant developing a new way of life, directed by a spirituality that deepened relationship with the land and waters and species we were seeking to protect. Spiritual and cultural transformation is what I hoped church would be about when I went to seminary 30 years ago. My first job after graduation was with World Vision, a global Christian humanitarian organization, in their advocacy and education department. For the entire year I was pregnant with my son, I researched and wrote a comprehensive toolkit to encourage churches to care for creation. That was the language we used back then in our attempt to shift from a worldview of dominion over nature, the traditional view, to stewardship of nature, is still inadequate framing as it retains the place of humans at the top of a hierarchy. The kit, called Let the Earth Be Glad, was sent to 50,000 evangelical churches. Books on the top of creation care were being published, with authors like Matthew Fox and Thomas Berry offering compelling ecocentric theologies and asking worldview-shifting questions. Though this was before much discussion on the connection between fossil fuels and the climate crisis, ecological problems like deforestation and polluted air and water were clearly harming the children and families World Vision served. The toolkit includes all kinds of items and ideas for churches, from exegetical studies and scriptural references of nature's revelation of God, Job chapter 12, verse 7, for example, "But ask the animals, and they will teach you," or "Speak to the land, and it will inform you," to projects for kids to learn about Jesus by considering the lilies and frogs. We even included a cassette tape. It was a long time ago, with nature sounds that churches could play during worship services. I was determined to encourage church leaders to bring nature inside to open the hearts of their congregants so they would care about nature outside our doors. I had to emphasize the impact on humans, how the children of poverty-stricken countries were harmed by ecological degradation, attempting to stay grounded in love rather than fear. The kit opened with this psalm: "Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound and all that is in it, let the fields be jubilant and everything in them, let all the trees of the forest sing for joy." While the design and language of the kit seemed clearly within the boundaries of Orthodox Christianity, I knew it would meet resistance. A whole section of the kit was essentially a defense. "No, we aren't saying you should worship the creation rather than the Creator. No, this isn't a liberal agenda. No." On top of that, the development department at World Vision was particularly nervous. One of their top donors was the Vajahoyza family, who owned the largest timber production business in the world. I was warned by the head of fundraising that this kit better not upset them. The fact that their multi-billion dollar income came from converting more than 13 million acres of forest into products for human consumption created a challenge for my project. It's tricky to talk about letting the trees sing for joy while they're stacked on the back of a semi-truck. Honoring the inherent spiritual value of the trees and the creatures of the forests was a politically charged line to walk 3 decades ago, just as it is today. I tried to navigate this line by opening the kit with a quote from an unlikely eco-theologian, a young girl from the beginning of the 20th century, who was neither liberal nor conservative. In 1902, Opal Whiteley was 5 years old and living in a logging town in Oregon. She kept a journal filled with old soul intimacy with the natural world, and she knew this intimacy as holy presence. "Morning is glad on the hills. The sky sings in blue tones. Little blue flowers are early blooming now. I do so like blue. It is glad everywhere. The earth sings in green. I did stop by some grand fir trees to pray. When one does look, looks up at the grand trees growing up almost to the sky, one does always have longings to pray." In rural America at that time, children were often regarded as farmhands. Opal's talk of connecting with field mice and joining lichen in worship was severely misunderstood and even punished. Her journal was ripped into pieces by her sister a few years after she wrote these words, but Opal kept all the pieces. At age 20, she meticulously reassembled the shreds like a puzzle. When a publisher recognized the beauty of her words and offered to print a small run of a book, I felt that Opal had a unique capacity for connection with the living world that was needed to break past the politics and resistance in the dominant evangelical church. Churchgoers needed words to engage their hearts. I included logic and statistics to satisfy the mind, but I sensed that the statistics and science would not bring about any kind of spiritual awakening. A heart-centered connection with a natural world was needed. The Let the Earth Be Glad kit was beautiful and well-received. I'm not sure how much spiritual or religious transformation it accomplished, if any, yet it set me on a path that I continue to follow today. It's a path I suspect you may be following as well. We may be called nature mystics, those who experience the presence of the sacred through nature. Nearly a millennium ago, another nature mystic, Hildegard of Bingen, engaged the world with a similar intimacy. A Benedictine abbess and one of only four women who were named Doctor of the Church, Hildegard's spirituality integrated mystical experiences with botanical knowledge, medicine, embodied desire, and music. Like Opal, Hildegard's connection with the presence of the sacred began when she was young and was experienced through nature. Sainted for her intensely intimate visions of God, she described the fecund, wild presence of Christ, as viretitas, which can be translated as something like the greening power of the divine, pulsating through all things. Not unlike Opal's earth singing in green, Hildegard wrote, "O most honored greening force, you who roots in the sun, you who lights up in shining serenity within a wheel that earthly excellence fails to comprehend, you are enfolded in the weaving of divine mysteries. You redden like the dawn, and you burn, flame of the sun." Separated by 800 years, these two women expressed a common mystical experience of the sacred nature of nature. Their words, like those of other mystics throughout history, invite us into a sacred conversation with the natural world. My personal spirituality is rooted in the Christ tradition, a term I prefer over Christian, which is a label I find difficult to swallow these days. Rather, I see myself as an edge walker, wandering along the hemlines of the Christ tradition. I stand at the inside edge of a tradition that has brought many people, including me, deep pain, and has also brought many people, including me, deep joy and meaning. I've adopted this term, edge walker, from nature writer Terry Tempest Williams. The Encyclopedia of Religion and Nature describes her edgewalking as traveling the narrow space between the religious tradition she credits for having forged her soul and her direct and very personal experiences in nature that have revealed a truth of their own. Perhaps you are an edgewalker too. Edgewalkers occupy a thin space and are by definition a bit lonely. Most people inhabit the vast spaces on both sides of edges, but those of us called to the thresholds, the edges between, live in this thin space and recognize one another when we meet. The edges between biosystems are called ecotones. These thresholds usually contain the most biodiversity and therefore are the most resilient. A shoreline, for example, is an ecotone edge between the water and the land. Matter from the sea and the terrestrial shore is exchanged in these intertidal zones, inviting more life forms to flourish. Those of us called to the ecotoned edges need one another. Kurt Vonnegut calls this kind of connection a charis. A word he made up that means a network or group of people who are somehow affiliated or linked spiritually. The time is coming soon when the edges we inhabit will start to redefine the center, and we will need to lean on and learn from one another as we, together, engage in the work of that redefining. Each of us is characterized by our own unique gifts, communities of influence, and a particular bioregion. But we cannot behave as silos. The more diverse our relationships are, the more resiliently we can hold our own individual edges. Every religion has an edge where the mystics live. I once attended a conference organized by Ed Bastian, a Buddhist mystic whose calling is defined by his deep respect for and encouragement of interfaith spirituality. He gathered spiritual leaders from diverse traditions to consider what we had most in common, living on the same planet. Cynthia Beaujeu was the spokesperson for the Christian tradition. She was joined by Jewish mystic Rami Shapiro, Sufi practitioners Kabir and Kamil Helminski, and their whirling dervish friends, Pravrajika Vrajaprana, a Hindu nun from the Vedanta convent, and Don Four Arrows Jacobs, a Native American college professor and activist for indigenous rights. We talked about how our faith traditions could connect us with the actual soil and water and creatures of Earth, and how that connection could be a spiritual foundation for the environmental movement. What I remember most was a golden thread of mystical connection with divine presence that all of us expressed in our relationships with the natural world. Even in our diversity, we all felt that we had more in common with one another, edgewalkers from other traditions, than we did with people more firmly planted in the center of our own faiths. Theologians may quarrel, but the mystics of the world speak the same language, Meister Eckhart observed in the 14th century. There have always been edgewalkers, those who didn't follow along with the status quo, who didn't swallow the version of religion offered by those on top of the hierarchy as the only way. And at that edge, spirituality and nature are in unbroken relationship. Mirabai Starr, herself a feminine mystic, can articulate this direct experience with the sacred and nature with a candor that is alluring and accessible. A mystic is someone who has an experience of union with the One. And the One may be God, it may be Mother Earth, it may be the cosmos. That experience is rare, but everyone has them, I think, where you momentarily forget that you are a separate ego, personality, self, and you experience your interconnectedness with all that is. A recent study demonstrates what Starr intuits. The study, seeking to learn the spirituality patterns of Americans, showed that nearly 6 in 10 adults often feel a deep connection with nature and the earth, whether they are affiliated with a religious community or not. It is my experience that most people have stories of a mystical encounter in nature, a time in which the veil of disconnection dropped and they were able to experience their deep belonging to an interconnected and sacred earth. But those of us caught in the dominant Western worldview do not have enough of a cultural context or a language to know what to do with those encounters. After the Let the Earth Be Glad kids were sent out back in 1994, I was invited to be part of a small group of Christian environmentalists who were gathering at O. Sable Institute, a Christian ecological retreat center in Michigan. This was my first trip to the Midwest, and as a Southern Californian, my first encounter with an actual autumn. Giant maple leaves in colors I'd only seen before in crayons, brilliant cadmium oranges, alizarin crimson, and yellow ochre, covered every stitch of dirt and sidewalk. They created a vibrant, pulsating mosaic that looked more like an impossible 1,000-piece puzzle than it did real life. It was hard for me to fully pay attention to the meeting with a leaf opera going on outside. but the group of us, 20 or so, sat at a conference table to discuss the ways we could engage the church in advocacy measures around the worsening ecological crises. We discussed an article written 25 years earlier by a historian from UCLA, Lynn White, Jr., who indicated Christianity as the primary culprit in determining our ecological crises. White cited the Christian axiom that nature has no reason for existence save to serve man as the primary force that continues to define our political, economic, and even ecclesial beliefs and practices. It was an awakening for me to see that Christianity not only has resisted engagement on environmental issues for political and otherwise confusing reasons, but has also been responsible for much of the worldview on hierarchy and separation itself. If my unreliable memory serves, my only real contributions to the discussion were periodic flashes of defensiveness. How dare he blame us Christians for this mess? And something like, "Humph," or other exceedingly unhelpful and clueless things. To be fair, I was also a wee delirious from lack of sleep. My 3-month-old son, Alec, whom I'd brought with me, caught his first cold on the plane and couldn't nurse well. I don't think I slept the entire conference. Though my mind was foggy, it was an apocalyptic moment for me, a moment of unveiling what has always been there. I needed to see how the Christian religion not only has colluded with the agendas of empire after empire throughout history, as it still does today, but is often used as a weapon of mass destruction. In this case, a justification for mass destruction of the planet, since, hey, heaven is our real home. I remember we all soberly accepted Professor White's critique and felt a responsibility as Christian leaders to do something. The discussion focused on helpful ideas and plans, and we all made earnest and well-intended commitments to one another and to God and the dancing golden leaves, or maybe that was just me. We committed to doing everything in our power to awaken the church to the crisis happening outside our doors. But more than awakening needs to happen. What we neglected to discuss at that meeting took me another 20 years to see. The very real, concrete changes our world desperately needs, but desperately resists, will not happen without a compassionate and intimate reconnection with nature. What we need can't be legislated or explained or resolved through a great social media campaign. What is needed is something that is deeply seated at the core of every religion, love. Mystical experiences in nature, those moments when you sense your interconnection with all things, are more than just interesting encounters. They're invitations into relationship. Beyond caring for creation or stewarding Earth's resources, it is entering into an actual relationship with particular places and beings of the living world that can provide an embodied, rooted foundation for transformation. The global shift necessary to actually survive the crises we've created depends on a deep inner change. Restoring relationship is, I believe, the true mission of religion. The word religion, at its roots, means re, again, and legios, connection, like ligaments. Religion is meant to offer a support to connect again what has been separated. Apparently, we need constant reminders to continually reconnect with the fullness of life, the whole, the holy. What we've created is more like dislegion, disconnection from people and species unlike us. When religion loses its purpose and colludes with the forces of separation instead, it becomes irrelevant and even irreverent. Through my love story, woven into the chapters of this book, I invite you to honor your own experiences of falling in love with the world. Well, not with the whole world, because that's too big, but with particular beings, those trees who live on your block, a certain crow who frequents your street, the shoreline on the edge of the village, are neighbors. The spiritual transformation that both scientists and spiritual people are all calling for is not about bringing nature inside for the church to remember that God's love covers everything. It's not about having churches play nature sounds on cassette tapes. It's about going outside and spending time with the other beloved ones of Earth and offering our tender, gracious attention to their needs as well as our own. That's what you do when you fall in love. This connection will give us the courage and the energy and even the ideas we need to challenge our prevailing consumerist mindset for the healing and restoration of our world. As simplistic as it sounds, I believe that only love is strong enough to bring about the change we need.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.